Lisa Nicholson says God is unique. Unique and perfect. Affirm, reaffirm. Affirm, reaffirm. Affirm, reaffirm. Affirm, reaffirm. I ask that every Satanist who ever smells diarrhea be nauseous and start vomiting an infinite number of times, every gazillionth of a second, for an infinite number of eternities. Affirm, reaffirm. Affirm, reaffirm. Affirm, reaffirm. I see the power of an infinite number of infinities. Gino says, I'm as beautiful as I ever was. Affirm, reaffirm. Affirm, reaffirm. Affirm, reaffirm. Affirm, reaffirm. To the power of an infinite number of infinities. Gino says, if I had been intelligent when we were together, he would have stayed with me. Affirm, reaffirm. Affirm, reaffirm. Affirm, reaffirm, to the power of an infinite number of infinities. Sometimes it takes a while to recognize that. I don't know everything. No. I reaffirm all God's requests for all Satanists. An infinite number of times, every gazillionth of a second. For an infinite number of infinity. I think Taylor Poole just said he's related to Florence Feller. I think Taylor Poole just said he's related to Florence Feller. Affirm, reaffirm. Affirm, reaffirm. Affirm, reaffirm. The power of an infinite number of infinities. I hadn't heard it that bad, did I? Florence Feller may have said she's related to Harpo and Groucho Marx, who are like Ayn Rand, utter capitalists. Affirm, reaffirm. Affirm, reaffirm. Lisa Nicholson asked to share her money with all Satanists. I affirm the request. Affirm, reaffirm. Affirm, reaffirm. Affirm, reaffirm. Affirm, reaffirm. The power of an infinite number of infinities. Dino says he's had his head up Richard Denny Sr.'s ass for so long. They're the two richest ones. impossible. Yeah. I'm sure you can control that. Satanists say God is to blame for all that they hate. Affirm, reaffirm. Affirm, reaffirm. Affirm, reaffirm. Affirm, reaffirm. The power of an infinite number of infinities. I ask not to have my sense of smell back until there is no more diarrhea in my environment, God. Affirm, reaffirm. Affirm, reaffirm. Affirm, reaffirm. I have an infinite number of infinities. Donna Jean Valkman Ellsberg says her reward is in heaven. Affirm, reaffirm. Affirm, reaffirm. To the power of an infinite number of infinities. I ask that Donna Jean Valkman Ellsberg keep striving for heaven. Intensity increasing an infinite number of times, every zillionth of a second, for an infinite number of infinities. Affirm, reaffirm. Satanists say they don't mind information being given out about them by the Holy Spirit of God. Uh-oh. Is that the truth again? I ask that Satanists be compelled to laugh and smile an infinite number of times, every gazillionth of a second for an infinite number of eternities, in all their eternal bodies for eternal torture, and whatever shit is here and in other people's vicinities. Affirm, reaffirm. Affirm, reaffirm. Affirm, reaffirm. Oh, but if I'm ever fine. Excuse me. If you have a deviated septum that needs to be cleaned out frequently, I recommend that you get your nails done. Satanists say they torture children of God and infants because they fuck their mommies. Firm reaffirm. Power of an infinite number of infinities.
To ask, I'm a scientist, but I see that Amazon has a really important role to play right now with the distribution of goods. But what we need to be aware of is I have my serious concerns that Amazon does everything they can actually to keep their workers as safe as they can, and we just need to be aware of that. We need to get back to that too, and it's the absolutely right decision of Lawrence Law and Eileen De Villa now to really say, okay, if we have an outbreak situation in a facility, we close these facilities. That's what is needed right now. We're too desperate.
Yeah, and just for our viewers, you're referencing Medical Officer of Health for Peel Region and for Toronto, where they have invoked this Section 22, where there have been five cases over the course of a week or so. They're shutting down that workplace, just so people understand that. Okay, Dr. Yunes, you say you are a scientist. So as a scientist, what is your biggest concern at this stage of the...
Quote, Section 22... Unquote.
Well, the biggest concern Gino reacted quite a bit. Our IC occupancy goes up.
Quote,
and up
Section
and up again.
22.
And remember,
unquote.
Everybody, I hope, is aware of that now. We're
Section
about
22.
Young people are on these ICUs, and it's a real challenge that we're facing there. We're really at the limits there. This means. Even though we probably manage now as a first step, which is excellent, that's because of all of us, doing the right thing, that the curve is flattening at the high plateau, we now need to get these numbers down as soon as possible. In addition, we need to use our vaccines as wisely as we can.
And that, by that, you mean target hotspot areas and target hotspot at-risk groups.
Exactly, including again essential workers and their families. We have a challenge right now that we just need to address. If we want to do that well, we now need to benefit also from the indirect effects of vaccines. That's new data that came out just a few weeks ago that really indicate now we not only directly protect that person by the vaccine from getting severely ill, but we also protect indirectly other people who are not yet vaccinated, because this person who gets vaccinated is less likely to transmit the disease. And we need to leverage both of those. So if we go into hotspots that are actually severely affected and try to vaccinate everybody we can above the age of 16 or 18, this will then be hopefully 70 or 80%. This means that we achieve something like herd immunity in this area. And what this also means is that everybody there is protected. protected, you know, those people at the highest risk. And it also means that these areas don't spill over to other areas, so everybody benefits. But this means we need to let go of the idea that we can do all of that just, you know, on a per capita basis, that the population...
Vivian
Bonastar
says, section
That's
22.
What needs to happen now.
Section 22.
Wisely, and want to make sure that the entire province benefits. The province benefits, then we get all the hotspots under control.
And that's certainly been something that Dr. Peter Lin has been advocating on our program for weeks now. Dr. Yuni, I want to thank you for your time. Please enjoy the rest of your weekend.
Thanks for having me.
Dr. Peter Yuni is the Scientific Director of the Ontario COVID-19 Science Advisory Table and a Professor of Medicine and Epidemiology at the University of Toronto. In Britain, a former key advisor to Boris Johnson is calling the Prime Minister unethical. Dominic Cummings, who was sacked earlier this year, says the British PM used political donations for home renovations. This is Dominic Politis is following the story, and he joins us from Bristol, England. So, Dom, let's talk about what Cummings is saying, and he's not short of words, is he?
No, that's right, Donny. Well, he's used his first blog post since leaving Downing Street last year. Firstly, to deny that he leaked text messages between Boris Johnson and Sir James Dyson, the creator of the Dyson vacuum cleaner. And those messages, John, were sent in March of last year, just after the government appealed for help from firms in building ventilators for Britain's pandemic response. And they show Boris Johnson promising to fix a tax issue for Dyson's Singapore-based staff if they move to the UK.
Section 22
now,
could be an SOS.
Denial, Dominic Cummings also makes a number of other explosive claims.
Section 22 could be an SOS.
Boris Johnson planned to get Tory donors to secretly pay for refurbishing his Downing Street apartment, and that Johnson suggested blocking an inquiry into another government leak about England's second national lockdown because the suspect was apparently a friend of his fiancée, Carrie Symons. But Cummings also alleges Johnson instructed his director of communications to make false accusations to the media, and he accuses Boris Johnson of, quote, falling far below the standards of competence and integrity which Britain deserves. So, explosive allegations and comments from
Boris Johnson could be
one of his closest allies at the time,
related to Rodney Dangerfield,
the Prime Minister, John, and it shows, I think, Dominic Cummings is willing to spill all about his time at the heart of British government. And
Boris Johnson, Prime Minister of the UK, could be related to Rodney Dangerfield.
Yeah, well, first off, the government, John, has denied any wrongdoing. It's insisting that ministers, including the Prime Minister, have acted in accordance with all the necessary rules, and that in particular, the costs of refurbishing the Downing Street apartment were met personally by Boris Johnson. But that statement just isn't enough for some opposition MPs, John, who are demanding the Prime Minister, Boris Johnson, fully discloses who actually paid for that work. Here's Sir Keir Starmer, the leader of the Labour Opposition Party.
It matters because it's about integrity and it's about taxpayers' money. You've got the former most senior advisor.
The Landsbergs could be related to Cary Grant.
Way below the standards of integrity that are needed.
The Landsbergs could be related to Cary Grant.
The former minister Dominic Grieve saying there's a vacuum of integrity. And every day there's more evidence of this sleaze. And
the Landsbergs could be related to Cary Grant. The Landsbergs could be related to Cary Grant. Boris Johnson might be related to Rodney Dangerfield. Boris Johnson might be related to Rodney Dangerfield. I don't know. I don't know.
just simply close my eyes and my mind would just be racing. I was trying everything. I heard bad about cold showers from someone that it helps reduce anxiety. This is one of the things that helped me get through some really difficult times. That cold shower sets the tone for the rest of my day.
Ago, I suffered from some pretty bad postpartum anxiety. Well, the main thing for me when I was kind of in the worst of it was making sure that I just had a routine. And then part of the routine is outdoor time, going outside for a nice walk. We live out in Lanark Highlands, which is in the middle of nowhere. It's very wooded where we are. Enough to have some trails that were made on the property that deer also like to use. Little rabbit tracks in the winter, you can see all the animals. And you can just hear the wind. You can just like feel the trees like breathing. It sounds weird, but like it's definitely like having a nature bath. We have a toddler, so it takes a long time to walk places. She takes little steps, and we take little steps. Being outside with the chicken and the guinea hens, it's fun for my daughter, and when I see her laugh, that makes me happy. So doing things that make you happy during the day and that fill you up are really important. Because I was probably dealing with this anxiety from the moment she was born. The anxiousness is kind of brushed off as normal feelings of just being an anxious new mom. It wasn't until I had my first panic attack that it really clicked with me that I was probably struggling with something a little more intense than just a run-of-the-mill. I'm 57 years old. I suffer from depression since I was 33. I couldn't wake up. During this time, I heard a friend introducing a book called 1 Minute. Where did you know? This is my beautiful 1 Minute. Where did you know? This one isn't the first one. Take you a couple minutes to write 3 to 5 things that you are grateful for a day or two. So how can you continue to write cleaning book? And I believe cleaning can be hard for your children. Even a very simple thing. So Ryan and Andrew have been working with me for the long hour, 400 minutes, which was took place now. And I'm gradually, it's magic as happened. It's a feeling, appreciate. And then it cultivates the attitude. I'm finally found out. And I figure out it's by doing this day to day, it's become a choice to be determined to be happy. Only remember my happy thing. It's very powerful. And the other thing, I joined this happy old club, actually. It's a cushioning club, repeating the things, one needle at a time, one needle at a time. And then gradually, you have a product coming out. It's a satisfying thing.
The best advice I could give to someone who's struggling with their mental health right now is you really gotta focus on what you can control, and you have to practice being positive. You're not entitled to being happy. You have to work to be happy.
I would say that you really need to take a moment for yourself during the day and give yourself grace. The most helpful thing is to control during this experience, like on an airplane. If your airplane is going down, or the oxygen mask drops, you put it on yourself first before you put it on someone else.
And I told myself, I know I've been there, I've done that, I know, no matter how deep, I've down there before, and I
So, I think, you know, in Canada, if we get 5,000 or 6,000 cases in a day, it's horrifying to so many people in this country. It seems really overwhelming. I can't imagine 346,000. It just seems surreal at this point. Give us a sense of what is going on across the country.
What I can tell you, Natasha, is that the healthcare system, the system has crashed completely. It has been paralyzed. It isn't that, you know, people weren't prepared. Yes, there were a lot of preparations underway at the federal level and at the state level as well. But the numbers are horrific, just like you stated. I mean, there are more than 300,000 cases coming every day. There are more than 2,000, 3,000 people dying every day in the country, particularly in the national capital, New Delhi, and the NCR region, and Maharashtra. There are five warning figures that are coming in. I'm talking to you right now from the national capital, New Delhi, where there is no oxygen that is available in hospitals. There are SOS calls being made by several prominent private as well as public hospitals, and oxygen is lacking. There's been a widespread criticism also of both the state as well as the central government, but this is an unprecedented crisis. Prime Minister of India, Narendra Modi, has been in fact working several days all through the day. Today and for the last few days, there's been some criticism also of the election rally control happening in West Bengal and some of the religious cabinets as well. But as of now, all preparations are for both beds to arrive in several hospitals in Delhi, because I have started with my friends, my network, a crisis helpline for COVID, and I have been seeing this kind of helplessness in people who are searching for beds, oxygen, or injections or medicine. So this is an unprecedented crisis that can't be there. And India is certainly tackling this bravely. I mean, it is only the resilience of the people on the streets of New Delhi and elsewhere in India that is keeping the nation going. But unfortunately, even in New Delhi, more than 350 people are dying every day. That means 15 deaths taking place every hour.
How did this happen? Because just a few months ago, India was doing fine. In fact, one of the leading world producers of the vaccine, they were sending vaccines to Canada. We were depending on those vaccines. And now, what was the switch, the catalyst to this dramatic surge in cases?
Well, Natasha, there are various reasons. One, as I mentioned, there's been a lot of criticism of the lackluster approach at the federal and the state level as well. There are several state governments that have been criticized for not preparing enough. And also the kind of hard line that was approached, the kind of discipline that was there over the last 1 year or so, had really, you know, gone haywire, because people were almost used to being in this, COVID-friendly environment, if I had to say. So the COVID-appropriate behavior hasn't really been, disciplined enough all across the country. Secondly, the government was prepared, but unfortunately did not understand or gauge that this kind of unprecedented numbers could also happen. Also, there is a new variant that is coming, and there are multiple new variants that are coming, not just in New Delhi, but in different other states as well. Which the scientists haven't been able to research, I will give you an example of my old friend who has been in his house for more than 2 weeks. He has had no, access to outside world, but he's going to post them as well. So, scientists are still trying to figure out how things are unfolding. But it doesn't seem like that things will get normal anytime soon in Delhi, at least for the next 15 to 20 days. The numbers are only going to swing up. As of now, as I speak, there's a lockdown underway for the last 1 week in the national capital, New Delhi. And if things remain this way, 25,000 cases coming in every day in the national capital, I sense a further lockdown, unfortunately.
25,000 possible cases every day. So, Aditya, help me. We don't have a lot of time left, but you talked about a sense of helplessness, but at the same time, so many people coming together, rallying together. There was so much activity on social media, trying to tell people where beds are available, where they can send donations, things like that. Just give me a sense of what this has done to the individual families who are struggling right now, who can't find hospital beds.
Well, I have messages in my inbox on Twitter, on all across the social media, and ask for help. And I've been posting that individually over the last many days. And unfortunately, there are no beds available in Delhi, government hospitals or private hospitals. And as I said, hospitals, each and every hospital in Delhi is running at 150% capacity. So you can imagine the lives of several innocents are at risk.
of view, and fortunately, a lockdown here in India is certainly going to help.
Example of my old friend who has been in his house for more than 2 weeks. He has had
posted as well. So, I mean, scientists are still trying to figure out how things are unfolding, but it doesn't seem like that things will get normal anytime soon in Delhi, at least for the next 15 to 20 days. The numbers are only going to swing up. As of now, as I speak, there's a lockdown underway for last 1 week in the national capital, New Delhi. And if things remain this way, 25,000 cases coming every day in the national capital, I sense a further lockdown, unfortunately.
25,000 possible cases every day. So, Aditya, help me. We don't have a lot of time left, but you talked about a sense of helplessness, but at the same time, so many people coming together, rallying together. I've noticed so much activity on social media, trying to tell people where beds are available, where they can send donations, things like that. Just give me a sense of what this has done to the individual families who are struggling right now, who can't find hospital beds.
Well, I have messages in my inbox, on Twitter, on all across the social media, and asking for help, and I've been posting that individually over the last many days. And unfortunately, there are no beds available in Delhi, government hospitals or private hospitals. As I said, you know, hospitals, each and every hospital in Delhi is running at about 50% capacity. So you can imagine the lives of several, you know, innocents are at risk. The patients are shattered. You know, it is the resilience of the common man here in India that is, you know, shaping the entire movement of helping the common people. There are several WhatsApp groups that have been created. There are individuals and NGOs and common people really coming out and helping people. I've been part of one, you know, helping manufacturers, and with doctors and individuals from the forces and different state of society, we are trying to help people. And you know, I'll give you an example of just you know, an hour back, it's midnight here in India. We were finally able to secure a bed for you know, father of an Indian Air Force personnel who was brought in a bed for the last 2 days, even though he was clinical. So you can imagine there was a thunderous applause virtually all across the world till then, after several hours, we were able to manage this bed for this individual. So I don't want to criticize the central government or the state government at this stage, because this is no time to, you know, for mudslinging. But, you know, the government needs to be prepared, and the worst perhaps is yet to come. We haven't touched this, you know, peak. I don't want to call this a second wave or the fourth wave as the politicians refer to this. But unfortunately, deaths are going to continue, the cases are going to continue, and unfortunately, a lockdown here in India is certainly going to continue.
Tap your shower just to the point where you can get it to start, and that's the coldest. That is like a challenge for me to stay under. Just being present. Can't really do much else to take about the truck over there. This is the focus. Is this? Come back into the present moment, because it's so freaking cold. Literally, I tell myself, if I can start my day with the hardest thing physically, the rest of my days are going to be easy.
Yeah, that's feeling. Feeling awake, feeling alive, feeling accomplished. Feeling that's the hardest thing I can usually do to start my morning.
I get anxious like first thing in the morning. I would call it my daily ambush. I would wake up, but I'm so tired from not sleeping properly that I wouldn't want to get up. And as I try to go back to sleep, I'm just simply closing my eyes and my mind would just be racing. I was trying everything. I read about cold showers for someone, that it helps reduce anxiety. This is one of the things that helped me get through some really difficult times. That cold shower sets the tone for the rest of my day.
Tracks in the winter, I can see all the animals. And then you just hear the sounds weird, but like, it's definitely like having a nature bath. We have a toddler, so it takes a long time to walk places. She takes little steps, and we take little steps. Being outside with the chicken and the guinea hens, it's fun for my daughter, and when I see her laugh, that makes me happy. So doing things that make you happy during the day and that fill you up are really important. Because I was probably dealing with this anxiety from the moment she was born. The anxiousness is kind of brushed off as normal feelings of just being an anxious new mom. It wasn't until I had my first panic attack that it really clicked with me that I was probably struggling with something a little more intense than just a run-of-the-mill. I'm 57 years old. I suffer from depression since I was 33. I can become beyond the doing this time.
The best advice I could give to someone who's struggling with their mental health right now is you really gotta focus on what you can control, and you have to practice being positive. You're not entitled to being happy. You have to work to be happy.
I would say that you really need to take a moment for yourself during the day and give yourself grace. The most helpful thing that's going to help me during this experience was, like on an airplane, if your airplane is going down or the oxygen mask drops, you think about yourself first before you think about somebody else.
And I told myself, I know I've been there, I've done that, I know, no matter how deep I've down there before, and I come out of it, I'm not scary anymore. It's a physical illness, it's a mental illness, it's a illness you just need.
The comic book book is not maybe five boxes of comic book.
Elizabeth Hardesty spent 5 years of her life fitting boxes of medical supplies into every nook and cranny of her small home. They were for her husband, Percy, who had end-stage renal failure. All the equipment needed for his care turned their home into an obstacle course.
All he had was like 4 feet, you know, little alleys in our house. So towards the end, like when he was basically missing, you know, sense of balance and mobility, it was quite concerning.
Percy died waiting for a home renovation that could have drastically improved his quality of life. The Hardesties couldn't afford to pay for a small room addition to store Percy's necessities. So they asked the NWT Housing Corporation for a loan. The Hardesty says, they never heard back.
Well, it just kind of, you know, makes you want to give up.
In the Northwest Territories, stories like this are common. Most homes in small communities are owned by the territorial government and managed by the Housing Corporation. Almost half are in dire need of repair. legislature launched a review of the housing corporation's policies, but it will take months to complete.
You know, we deal with this on a daily basis.
Advocates say the territory needs to keep the agency accountable.
Because there really isn't any kind of independent type of oversight where people can actually bring their concerns.
The housing corporation says anyone needing help should go to their district office. Hardesty says that's not enough. She wants a dedicated representative to help people navigate the complicated system, in the hopes that other families don't struggle in their homes the way her husband did in his final days. Anna Demarest, CBC News, Fort Simpson, Northwest Territories. These doctors, nurses, and other health workers kept their demonstration short today. They don't want to be gathering, but feel they have no other choice.
Stop playing politics with people's lives!
Outside of the provincial legislature, the healthcare workers demanded employer-paid sick days and prioritizing essential workers and marginalized communities in the vaccine rollout.
People are dying, and that's why we're out here, and that's why we're asking for the specific measures that we know is based in evidence.
The number of patients in Ontario ICUs with COVID-19 has been steadily increasing, reaching a record high each day for the past 19 days.
We're seeing people in the waiting room who should be in the ICU. Vaccines. I want vaccines like tomorrow. I want vaccines immediately.
So do the hundreds of residents who have been spending hours waiting in lineups like this one in Downsview, a Toronto COVID-19 hotspot.
We just like line up early, hoping that, you know, they haven't run out of vaccines.
Right now, a quarter of the province's vaccines go to hotspots. On Friday, Ontario's COVID-19 science advisory table said that number should go up to 50%, saying it would reduce case counts, hospitalizations, and deaths.
I would actually push even further or reframe the science table's recommendation and say, how comfortable are we allowing to continue to see people die and suffer in these neighborhoods?
These are our nearest Canadians, our racialized Canadians, and to the extent that those structural inequities existed even before the pandemic, I think the pandemic simply worsened them.
Doctors know it'll be a while before they see relief.
I've never been more anxious in this pandemic. Like this.
Last week, Premier Doug Ford promised a paid sick leave program is coming. His office says they'll have more to say about it in the coming days. Talia Ricci, CBC News, Toronto.
Dire. I can't reduce and cut costs any more than I have.
My key worst is in survival. He runs his pizza restaurant as best he can these days.
I have 5 employees that all been laid off. I do 100% of the work. Accounting, ordering, cooking, answering the phones, and still not making a profit. So if I keep doing it, I don't understand why I'm breaking my see a light at the end of the tunnel.
That was the mindset Mike was in when he sat down to watch the budget.
I'm not a political guy. I'm just a hard-working, just average Joe, so it was weird for me to really be watching every word when that budget came out. It was kind of like Game 7 with, like, the Maple Leafs versus Montreal Canadiens in Stanley Cup Final, Game 7 in the third period. I was waiting for it. I was watching every moment of it.
What Mike was looking for specifically was a continuation of the emergency rent subsidy, or SERBS, that keeps the door open. And he got it.
I was elated. I almost was screaming because without that, I already was planning the June 5th closing. I wasn't going to make enough money out of my own pocket to pay rent. The extension of SERBS was the Maple Leafs winning in overtime in Game 7 for me. That allows me the opportunity to maybe weather the storm.
And that's one of the ideas behind the budget, to help people like Mike get their business through the pandemic. forces at cost. Canada's deficit is projected to be $354 billion, and the debt, $1.4 trillion by 2026.
I understand debt. I've seen every aspect of that. Debt for successful investments and debt that drove people into despair. I've seen it. That's Ron Butler. In his 25 years as a mortgage broker, he's seen the way we think about debt change, big time. We used to worry a lot about a $38 billion deficit. There was all kinds of discussion about that. So now we're running 10 times that. And I don't hear very much concern from anyone.
What's changed from sweating about 38 million to 10 times?
Certainly COVID happened. That's a big change. There was such a need to get money to people who lost their jobs that a big deficit was expected. So we did go into a $345 million deficit. The sky didn't fall in. I mean, nothing went too wrong. So why not just do it again? We'll see how this rides out.
Ron says he sees the same spending behavior that the governments do with every income. He says we've forgotten that risk of taking on too much debt.
That's exactly what happens in the mortgage business. The people who buy their homes once, some large payment, maybe about the same payment, as rates went down. Let's do it again. Rates are even lower. Let's refinance again. Let's get a bigger mortgage. Let's renovate the basement. Let's do this. Let's do that. Until the day comes when it doesn't work out. If I had grandchildren, what am I sadly?
You can argue about money for the present crisis versus future debt. But for someone like a ZDU, there's no pain. Every month she risks being evicted.
You got that news number. I've got new notices out my door. You're late. You took my evicted.
Ziki's a mom of three. Before the pandemic, she was a cleaner. But in the last year, since COVID, she's only been able to work twice. And she says Sarah is not enough.
When it comes to paying the rent for buying food, it's a toss-up. I have to be thinking if I'm going to pay the rent or if I'm going to buy food. If I'm going to be able to feed my children or I'm going to be evicted. So it's not a nice feeling when you have to be thinking about one or the other.
The CFP tells me that for her, the budget was a disappointment.
I don't think the budget has done enough. The budget had not done enough to cover our needs, and I don't think that they even consulted with us. What do you need? What can we do for you? How does this budget will help you? When you're in low income, you're not able to say, oh, the budget is too much, you know, there's a deficit. Understand that there's a deficit, but right now we need the assistance.
Aziki wants to get back to work and support herself, but for now, because of COVID, she's stuck. And that's the case for thousands of Canadians across the country. Mike's in the same boat. He hates that he can't support himself, but he needs government help to stay open.
The reason why I'm here, the reason why I'm passionate about the budget is to feed my family. That they're safe, they're sheltered, they're fed, keep them comfortable. I mean, this is the only reason why I'm here. And again, I don't know how long I can do that. And that's what's scary about this.
After more than a year of COVID, the only thing we know is that the future is uncertain. And a budget all by itself can't bring any of that. Lindbergh, 16 years from.
It's deja vu inside Alberta hospitals. Exponential community spread driving hundreds of patients into hospital beds.
This is our third week. Should be better at this by now. We know what works. We're reading the numbers. We know that it takes good government policy.
Alberta's daily case rate this week is the worst in the country by far. And healthcare workers say hospitals are going to shoulder that burden. As of today, 600 people were in hospital. 140 in intensive care, numbers approaching the heights of the second wave.
We are going to exceed the last wave of rescue by a large number, and the only thing that's going to limit that is the announcement of restrictions.
The last round of restrictions, brought in early this month, ban and diamond service and put caps on business. On Friday, Alberta's health minister said they won't rule out more.
Our leadership.
Numbers are fueled by variants. The majority of patients in Alberta hospitals have the B117 variant, first discovered in the UK.
We're starting to now see people in their 20s, 30s, and 40s, you know, presenting with severe COVID-19 and facing the real proposition of needing to be placed on a ventilator to save their life.
In tourist popular but tiny Banff, with cases soaring, locals are calling for a targeted solution. Residents want all adults vaccinated.
I'm fighting against the virus coming from all places in Alberta. It's not fair. It's a small community. Yeah, you know, only so many resources.
And Alberta hospitals are in the same boat. Erin Broman, CBC News, Winnipeg.
Hello, I'm John Northcott. Time now for your weekend business panel. Here's a look at some of the business stories we're tracking for you. The new federal budget, what the new plans could mean for your pocketbook. Also ahead, the Bank of Canada signals a rosier outlook for the economy, predicting economic growth of 6.5% this year. Plus, Ontario promises a plan to help workers gain safety. Here to help us talk about all that and more, Jessica Yamwa is the founder and CEO of Innovate, Inc. Michael Hyatt, an entrepreneur and investor, and Dina Amarhawk is a personal finance columnist and a regular contributor to CBC. Welcome to you all. Let's talk about this new federal budget unveiled just this past week, including proposals to continue supporting Canadians through the pandemic, and a look ahead at what comes next, $15 minimum wage, a luxury tax. A lot in there. What stands out for you, Jessica? Do you want to start us off?
Sure. Well, I think it's interesting that we are, while we're speaking of it now, what we're doing in the budget is setting up the Canada of the future. And I think by the federal government not tabling a budget in 2020, it gave them an opportunity to really look at the areas of the economy that need to be tabled, or that need to be targeted, I should say, and at the same time it exposed the communities or groups or people that were being overlooked. So when you see the call-outs like the old age pension, to your point, the raise in the raise in minimum wage, even some of the funding that's been allocated, like the $300 million to the Black community, it really shows that it takes general efficiencies to see the deficiencies in the Canada that we've been living in.
As you say, Jessica, long time coming, 2 years. 751 pages, someone commented that's a page for every day since we had our last budget. But Michael, what's your take on it?
Well, the good news is there's lots of spending, and the bad news is there's lots of spending. It's always interesting to see what actually comes out of this when we get going. You know, in particular, I thought it was really good that we really pushed the child care agenda. When that came into Quebec in the mid-90s, if you look at women's participation in the workforce, it's skyrocketed. I think it's very positive. The problem is, how are the provinces going to participate, and where are they going to get the money to do this? I think this is very much an election budget, but I'm not sure that they're going to actually get to implement everything, because the provinces are in a very, very bad place. The pandemic is very hard hitting in places like Ontario, which is the kind of powerhouse of our economy. There's a lot of suffering going on. It's going to be very, very difficult off the ground. I guess the most negative thing I thought was this class warfare idea of luxury taxes, that we have to, anybody wants to buy a nice car, then they have to pay extras and all this kind of stuff. This eat the rich idea is very silly. Besides that, I think that, they have to spend, and this is in line with, you know, America and Europe and everywhere else. We've got to stimulate, we've got to get more vaccines in arms, which we're failing to do.
$100,000 or more for an aircraft, so Piper Cub owners, you're okay. Boats over $250,000. You get a pretty good boat for $250,000. Rubina, what's your take on
that? I think it's interesting that it took a female finance minister to finally make a commitment in a big way to nationalize child care. It's a game changer for working moms, especially women of color, women in low-income backgrounds. We have had a very little access to child care that we can afford. If you look at a city like Toronto, where a toddler intake daycare costs almost $1,600 a month, that's someone's rent, that's someone's mortgage. That is unattainable for many women who have children, especially if they're doing it on their own, to be able to go to work full-time, to be able to go to school. All of those things then become impossible to do. And then they start to look at alternatives. Can they use family members? Can they use unlicensed daycare? So that's the one I was most impressed by. I agree, it is an election budget. There was something in there for everyone. No one was left behind. Even the rich even though they might not like it, the luxury tax. I wanted to hear a little bit more about how they're going to help first-time home buyers and young people get into the housing market. Home prices are up 30% year over year. A lot of people, young people, thinking, I'm never going to get on the property ladder. What more can you do to help them get there?
Okay, separate but not unrelated topic, let's talk about the economic outlook coming from the Bank of Canada. Governor Tim Macklin seems to be more than optimistic these days. Take a listen.
Third wave is a new setback, and we can expect some of the job gains we've seen get reversed. But the performance of the economy in recent months has increased our confidence in the underlying strength of the recovery.
Better times ahead, he says, remarkable resilience, projecting a 6.75% growth globally this year, 6.5% for Canada. Jessica, what do you think?
Well, I think it's a reflection of the aggregate. It's a little slightly aggressive. In terms of the economy being optimistic, we need that to get things going coming out of the pandemic. But at the same time, I guess it's more so about what are the drivers, what is going to drive this economy rather than just the standard equation. And is it, what does it mean for the government to make the statement, and how does that impact the average Canadian? Like the ability to access the everyday or an item like a Dollarama, where it might be a dollar, and now that we're in a pandemic and things are blocked off, you're forced to go to one of the major retailers where it might be $4 or $5 versus the one. So it's about the accessibility and how are we going to be able to drive the economy to hit that aggressive number.
He says this remarkable resilience, he does point out that low-wage workers, young people, and women likely not to experience this exuberance in the same way or certainly now as fast. Michael, your take on his remarkable, arguably, because it's a 2023 before we see any movement or rise in interest rates. What was your take on what he said this week?
Yeah, I feel like a broken record, but I'm going to say it again and again. I mean, if you just take a look at our largest trading partner, 80% of our volumes go to the United States. They're in a position right now by June, they're in a deluge of vaccines. My friends in New York, there's so many vaccines, they don't know what to do with it. And they're going to be kind of fully vaccinated. Anybody wants one pretty much around now in the next 30 days. Their economy is going to come roaring back, and in a real, real way, you can see the stimulus going on there. We're going to be trading there, but I don't even know if we're in a position this year to open up our borders because we're so far behind. Even if everybody gets a first shot, you still need a second shot and then maybe a booster. I think it's a prolonged problem for Canada. I think they have to be very, very careful about who this recovery is for. The stats show that income is up above 20% above the baseline if you're medium to wealthy, and then everybody below that is still below that line. It's not a good day. So it's a bad news story, good news story. It's not great. I think Canada's, I think, for instance, I think Tip is fantastic and he's very, very smart. I think he's right. The problem here is that we can't open up our economy. I don't know if anybody's taken a walk down Queen Street, on Bloor Street in Toronto. There are, every retail's boarded up. I don't mean they're gone, the leases are gone. They're not coming back in a month. There's a lot of pain. There's a lot of problems right now. So I don't see this roaring back for everybody until well into 2022 in Canada.
Yeah, Tim Macklin does say, though, that a lot of Canadians have managed to save money. Rubina, you're the personal finance expert here. What is your take on what the Government of Bank of Canada had to say?
Well, he's banking a lot on the hundreds of billions of dollars that a certain segment of Canadians have been able to save. So those are people who have kept their jobs, they've been able to work from home safely, they haven't been essential workers where they have to go out and perhaps isolate off and on for two weeks at a time where maybe they won't get paid. So these are people, and then they also had things like restaurant expenses fall, travel expenses fall, the kids weren't in any activities. I mean, someone like me, basically, I've been working from home and I've seen my expenses go down dramatically because all the regular things that I do no longer are happening, so I've been able to save. So they're really relying on people like me to go out and then spend money on restaurants and travel and buying things, which I think will happen. I think as soon as they press go, I am definitely going to start doing all of those things that I miss. But is it going to be sustainable? I mean, there's only so many restaurants you can eat at, even in the first year. There's only so much vacations you can go on. And they're really being very optimistic that everybody is in this frame of mind. We've talked about it before. A lot of people are permanently changed when it comes to how they feel about being out in public. So we're not going to have the same kind of consumer after the pandemic. A lot of people are going to be afraid to actually go out and sit shoulder to shoulder in restaurants, in malls, and concerts. And that means money not going into the economy.
John, can I comment that I think we really screwed this up here in Ontario? There's the, you know, a guy sitting at home who's 55 and doesn't leave the house as an accountant. We're giving him a shot first, you know? We screwed that up. We just let's just call it out for what it is. People, I mean, if you can work from home, you've made more money. If you can't work from home, you've made a lot less money. That's what's happened. And it's been an immense wealth transfer. And that's the problem here. It's a very bad news story for a huge marginalized part of this population.
Well, to Michael's point. Go ahead, yeah. Right.
No, just to add to that, even if you look at entrepreneurs, and to Rubina's point earlier, when you're talking about going to restaurants, a number of the restaurants across Toronto, across Canada, they're small businesses, they're micro businesses. So you're looking at family-owned businesses that are closed because they haven't been able to be as resilient as they've called out in this pandemic. So to your point about being forever changed, they're non-existent. So to say that to an entrepreneur or a very small business, it just doesn't resonate.
Yeah, to some of what both Jessica and Michael are saying, just on sick days, after months of pressure, Ontario Premier Doug Ford says that he is working on a plan to provide sick pay for workers. This is to a bridge until the federal money kicks in, and there's been criticism of both the federal program and the province for not bridging that. So let's talk about this paying for sick days. Who should pay for it? Jessica?
Well, I think we need to be the leaders that we are as Canadians, and companies should definitely step up and subsidize paid sick days. I mean, it's a benefit to the companies, it's a benefit to society, and first and foremost to their employees, if that's what their value is. If you look at in the 1960s, the average CEO versus the lowest or their entry-level employee, the difference or the margin was approximately 20 times 20. So imagine now, like paid sick day should be a standard. And again, you have to think about where does this leave entrepreneurs in terms of addressing blind spots and inequities that are affecting Canadians now from different socioeconomic levels.
Yeah, and again, giving particular communities some kind of leg up or at least trying to level the playing field. Michael?
Well, according to extreme circumstance, I mean, I think that tons of money has to be put in for sick days right now. But again, that's a band-aid. But look, for 2021, 2022, I think the government has to step up businesses. You're asking businesses that are suffering immensely. I mean, I can't even tell you how many companies are not coming back, even when you're back. And I think this, everybody's dreaming that everybody gets a single shot and everybody's going to rush out to restaurants. I totally agree with Rubina. It's not going to happen. It's not going to happen the same way. There's only two organizations that have made a lot of money out of this. And you're Amazon or you're Army of the Rebels at Shopify. Because I don't know about you, but you just stay home and how many boxes come. And the Purelator truck comes and the FedEx truck comes. And that's what we all do now, right? And I'm not sure that we're going to go back to anything. So, sure, sick days are fine and the money's going to pile in. But unless we get enough vaccinations and we're way behind and we beg from our neighbors, like, you know, the United States, we're going to fall back to 2023 right now. I think that, we have no option but to pay for sick days right now, and that should have been probably done last year.
Marina, last word to you.
We need paid sick days. Quebec is the only province in Canada that actually has paid sick days. After 3 months of work, you can get 10 paid sick days. The government will help you that way. There is no reason why the government, especially in a pandemic, should not be paying people to stay home when they do feel sick. It's $100,000 for somebody in the ICU and maybe a couple of hundred bucks for them to stay home so they can go and get a COVID test to make sure that, you know, they're not sick. So even if you look at it from an economics point of view, a bottom line taxpayer money point of view, it just makes sense. Even my personal finance brain can tell you that that is the one, that's the better option, is to prevent people who are sick going into workplaces, making more people sick, shutting your business down, having to quarantine. That's way worse. Just pay them a couple of, whatever it is, daily rate, and let them stay home so they can get better, get tested, and then come back if they're sick.
Everybody, thank you so much for another great panel. And thanks for joining us on the Weekend Business Panel. Jessica Yamois is a founder of CEO of Innovate Inc. Michael Hyatt, entrepreneur and investor, and Rubina Amethal is a personal finance columnist and regular contributor to CBC. Remember, you can watch the Weekend Business Panel Saturdays after our news update at 10 a.m. Eastern, right here on CBC News.
Inside each of these cars is someone gasping for air, and it's a singular scene. Swalia's days are full of worry and frustration. He has family in northern India. One relative died of COVID 5 days ago. Some of his cousins are now infected. He's particularly worried about his 7-year-old mother, who's isolated at home.
She's not able to go outside because of that fear of being infected. I can't even fly.
He's so scared
that
if he clicks there, he turns my boots into a business. My brand is encouragement. My vibe is hope. And I am DanteColley.com. Make a different future. Start different at GoDaddy.com.
The fear is that the death toll is much higher than what's officially being reported. Wire Stewart, CBC News, Vancouver.
Advisor to Boris Johnson is calling the Prime Minister unethical. Dominic Cummings, who was sacked earlier this year, says the British PM used political donations for home renovations. This is Dominic Collett. This is following the story, and he joins us from Bristol, England. So, Dom, let's talk about what Cummings is saying, and he's not short of words, is he?
No, that's right, Johnny. Well, he's used his first blog post since leaving Downing Street last year. Firstly, to deny that he leaked text messages between Boris Johnson and Sir James Dyson, the creator of the Dyson vacuum cleaner. Those messages, John, were sent in March of last year, just after the government appealed for help from firms in building ventilators for Britain's pandemic response. And they show Boris Johnson promising to fix a tax issue for Dyson's Singapore-based staff if they move to the UK to help. Now, aside from that denial, Dominic Cummings also makes a number of other explosive claims in his 1,000-word blog. He alleges that Boris Johnson planned to get Tory donors to secretly pay for refurbishing his Downing Street apartment, and that Johnson suggested blocking an inquiry into another government leak around England's second national lockdown because the suspect was apparently a friend of his fiancée, Carrie Symons. But Cummings also alleges Johnson instructed his director of communications to make false accusations to the media, and he accuses Boris Johnson of, quote, falling far below the standards of competence and integrity which Britain deserves. So explosive allegations and comments from Boris Johnson's former top aide and one of his closest allies at the time, a no-holds-barred attack on the Prime Minister, John, and it shows, I think, Dominic Cummings is willing to spill all about his time at the heart of British government, and that will be worrying for Boris Johnson and other Downing Street officials, John.
Well, let's talk about what kind of reaction we're getting from the Prime Minister's office now.
Yeah, well, first off, the government, John, has denied any wrongdoing. It's insisting that ministers, including the Prime Minister, have acted in accordance with all the necessary rules, and that in particular, the costs of refurbishing the Downing Street apartment were met personally by Boris Johnson. But that statement just isn't enough for some opposition MPs, John, who are demanding the Prime Minister, Boris Johnson, fully discloses who actually paid for that work. Here's Sir Keir Starmer, leader of the Labour opposition party.
Matters because it's about integrity. It's about taxpayers' money. You've got the former most senior advisor to the Prime Minister saying he's fallen way below the standards of integrity that are needed for the office of Prime Minister. You've got the former Minister, Dominic Grieve, saying there's a vacuum of integrity. But every day there's more evidence of this sleaze, and frankly, it stinks.
John, and other opposition MPs say that the claims show the government is neglecting the British people, that it is mired in sleaze, and they have called for a full investigation into the issue.
Those are some strong words. Thanks for this, Dominic. This is Dominic Collett. Thanks, Dominic.
Pazio spoke to us a week after a racist attack left him bloodied and bruised and with a
his night in hospital still hazy, the vicious attack still haunting.
That made me afraid to wear my own skin.
It happened in this field just behind where I'm standing. Pazio, a grade 8 student at Roslyn Junior High, was leaving school to go catch a bus. That's when a group of students chased and tackled him to the ground. The boys called him the N-word and made monkey sounds at him, Pazio says.
I could not remember the day. I couldn't remember that much, and my head really hurt, and my neck.
Pazio says his attackers are friends with a student who threatened him last year and was expelled for. When similar threats escalated this month, Pazio was fearful, staying home for 2 days. When he returned, his fears came true.
It was not right, and it was not supposed to happen. And the school should have done something.
I think I'm going to get to justice.
This weekend, the school said students involved in the assault have been held accountable, but it won't say what that entailed, citing privacy laws. Advocates say the incident reaffirms the need for continued anti-racism education for staff and students.
We don't want a 10-year plan. We don't want a 5-year plan. It has to be in these next upcoming months to a year. Otherwise, we know it's just performative. We're not here for that anymore.
Police say they are investigating, but the family is upset with how they questioned Pazio, saying the officer pressed him on whether he had started the fight. The family has stopped counting on the school for support, turning to community groups as they consider their next steps. Jordan Olmstead, CBC News, Edmonton.
Welcome back. Well, the international charity Doctors Without Borders is urging rich countries to take steps to allow more coronavirus vaccines to be produced right around the world. It is a topic that's sparking debate among members of the World Trade Organization. Now, intellectual property rights prevent other countries from making domestic versions of vaccines. But waiving these rights would allow developing nations to produce vaccines without fear of reprisal. Over 100 Nobel laureates and 75 world leaders, former world leaders, have already signed a letter to the U.S. President Joe Biden, calling on him to suspend patents during the pandemic. But resistance to this plan, well, it has been fierce. The U.S., the U.K., and the EU all voted in March to block any waiver. Canada says it has not rejected the proposal, but here is more of what we are hearing from Doctors Without Borders. Take a look. They say, quote, we urge all countries in opposition to this, including the U.S. and the EU, to stand on the right side of history and join hands with those in support. It is about saving lives at the end, not protecting systems. Well, joining us now is one of the Nobel laureates who signed this letter to the U.S. President Joe Biden, the University of Alberta's Dr. Michael Houghton. Won the 2020 Nobel Prize in Medicine for his discovery of the hepatitis C virus, and he is currently working on a vaccine for COVID-19. He joins us in San Francisco. Dr. Houghton, thank you for being with us today.
My pleasure.
Now, we have to note the fact that you've worked with pharmaceutical companies, with the industry for years now, but you have actually decided to sign on to this letter. Why?
Well, I think we're in a dire crisis, obviously, with this terrible pandemic. And I think emergencies require innovative solutions. We're simply not getting enough vaccine to poorer countries. It's so slow, and we have to do something about it. So this is very unusual to suspend patents, but I think it's justified to try to rectify this inadequate supply of vaccines to developing and poorer countries.
Okay. You say inadequate supply, but what would dropping a patent effectively do?
Well, it enables countries around the world to use the patent to manufacture their own vaccines without being sued by the companies that own those patents. So it gives a free license, essentially, for different countries to manufacture vaccines. And many countries, this has been led by India and South Africa, believe it's required to give their populations vaccine faster.
He steps here and if he clicks there, he turns my boobs into a business. My brand is encouragement. My vibe is hope. And I am DanteColley.com. Make a different feature. Start different at GoDaddy.com.
So patents there are very stimulatory. They are responsible for innovation, and most of the medicines we have today are because of the patent system, so it's a very good system. But in this circumstance where we have this terrible pandemic, we need to respond in different ways. We can't just rely on old methods. We're simply not getting enough vaccine to most countries of the world. And as a result, people are dying. And so I think extreme situations require extreme measures. And that's why I think it's a good idea to suspend COVID vaccines patents temporarily.
It's interesting that you use the word global, because it does raise quite literally a first world issue here, because many people in wealthy countries like Canada understandably are focused on their own pandemic protections, but they're also not thinking about poor countries that cannot buy vaccines the way Canada has to respond to this pandemic. So what do you say to that kind of thinking, that people are really only focusing on their own countries and perhaps maybe a neighbor country like the United States or other Western countries like
Yes, I would say that this is a global pandemic, and none of us can be truly completely protected until most of the world's citizens are vaccinated, at least 80%, so that we have herd immunity around the globe. So none of us will be completely protected until all the world's population, or 80% at least, are vaccinated. So it's protecting ourselves, as well as doing the right thing to make the vaccine more available to poorer countries around the world. We cannot really justify any situation where rich countries are being protected and not poor countries. And there are other things that have to be put in place besides suspension of patents, like rectifying global supply chains. Different countries will have to put in place complex biomanufacturing facilities. They're going to require not just patent suspension, but technology transfer from the companies. But I think this is what we need to do. So patent suspension is one of the things we've got to do. And we've just got to be better about working together to make sure everyone around the world gets vaccinated in the fastest possible time.
You say have to be better at working together. And earlier on this pandemic, there seemed to be more global cooperation. What do you say now to this situation? Got worse as this pandemic has gone forward?
Well, I think, as you said, it's natural that countries, individual countries, have first priority on their own citizens. That's why we elect our officials to look after us. But, you know, all of us also want to see other people protected. And so I think we have to, you know, break the mold temporarily. And you know, I think it will be a wonderful thing also, humanitarian-wise, for all of us to say, well, okay, we're going to do this because, you know, we are citizens, all citizens on a small planet, and viruses do not respect boundaries and immigration control. And so this is for them and it's for us. We have to work together better to solve this pandemic.
Now, this letter focuses on the U.S. president, but now the WTO is being raised, the World Trade Organization, that of course being a global decision-making body. So how important would it be to have Biden on side? How important would it be for the United States to change its sort of position on patents? And what role does that create for countries like Canada?
Yeah, I think it would be enormously important to have the support of President Biden. Also, the Canadian government, who has said so far it will rely on the consensus decision at the WTO, and I think that's good. But we need the support of the UK government and the EU. And I think it's difficult because it's innovatory, and we're not used to this kind of situation. But I really would urge all governments around the world to get on board this. It's one of the things we really need to do to solve this global pandemic. And I think it will be just a wonderful gesture for all mankind to say, look, we're finally figuring out how to help everyone, not just ourselves.
Dr. Michael Howden, thank you for this.
Thank you, sir.
Well, we want to get to some breaking news right now, and this is in Southern Ontario, where two Amazon fulfillment centers have now been partially closed to control COVID-19 outbreaks. Now, the order is from Peel Regional Public Health. It's for Amazon's facilities in Brampton and Moulton, Ontario. New regional rules, they do allow temporary shutdowns of workplaces where five or more COVID cases have been detected over a two-week period. just released this statement about the closures. It reads as follows: nothing's more important than the health and safety of our employees and the communities we serve. We have done and are doing everything we can to support them. Our most recent round of mandatory testing confirmed a positivity rate of approximately 1%, and there appears to be little risk of spread within our facility. I will keep tracking that for you, but these closures do come as Ontario tries to stem its surging COVID-19 numbers. The province reporting 4,094 new cases today. That is slightly down from yesterday, and sadly, there were also 24 more deaths. As Ontario's numbers rise, so is the number of people needing treatment in the hospital, and many are even being transferred hundreds of kilometers away, in particular in the Greater Toronto Area, as we and Laura McQuillan goes along on this story. So, Laura, talk to us about how hospitals right now are busy trying to relieve some of the pressure they currently face.
Yeah, they're having to see dozens of patients per day, maybe to other hospitals and more room for ICU patients to free up their own ICU beds. What we've learned is that in the past day there have been another 38 patients transferred, and in fact this month 747 patients so far. So this month alone, we're not at the end of the month yet, there have been more than half of the year's total. Such is the rise in the number of patients needing intensive care beds and the effort to find their beds somewhere in the province. As you mentioned, it could be hundreds of kilometres away. We're talking going from Toronto to Ottawa or to Windsor or to Owen Sound, just to try and find room for them on flights and ambulances, as you're seeing here on the screen. Doctors have been warning of this for months, the situation in intensive care units, and an expression I keep hearing is Ontario is on fire, but the fire really is burning the hottest in those intensive care units, to the point where we're having these patients transfers in Ontario, and also where field hospitals are opening up. One at Sunnybrook Hospital is set to open its doors on Monday, according to doctors who work at that hospital. You see it there, military-style tents set up in a parking lot. That facility will take in some 84 patients who are recovering from COVID. But the hospital says that it could relieve some other hospitals if they do need to transfer patients there as well, because that squeeze is expected to continue. Right now, 833 patients in intensive care in Ontario, that is around double what we saw at the peak of the second wave, a number that is expected to keep growing. Nearly three quarters of those patients on ventilators, just to give you an idea of how bad things are. And we have been getting an idea of that from Dr. Shandy Amshala, and he is the head of general surgery at Sunnybrook Hospital, where you saw that field hospital. He's been walking us through what all of this means, the flow-on effects for elsewhere in the healthcare system in terms of surgery particularly. Here is something that he told us.
We have shifted into what we're calling the crisis standard of care. That means that the normal standard of care that Ontarians deserve and expect is no longer an option for many disease processes because of the impact of our COVID-19 patients on our system. Everybody needs to know that there are patients out there who should be having their cancers removed that are sitting with their cancers in their body, waiting patiently for it to happen to them. We need to know the gravity of what's happening.
And Dr. Ashimala telling us that he was just in the sense of disbelief when he heard from the Ontario government that they had been waiting to see if the modelling would flow through to intensive care units, because that is exactly where we find ourselves now. The modelling was realised. He is urging the government to do more to stem the number of cases heading into ICU, with measures that we've heard many people talking about, including protecting essential workers, because doctors have been crying out for weeks and months now, Michael. They are so concerned not just about where the intensive care units and the hospitals are now, but where things will go next, because it will be at least a few weeks before new restrictions take their effect in hospitals.
And Laura, thank you for that, Obama.
Game played by tens of millions, FIFA Soccer, made by industry giant EA Electronic Arts. Embedded in the game, a mode where players can buy what's called a loot box card pack, either with coins earned in the game tune in to scenes like this. Gamers simply opening card packs, finding out what player they got. But for some people, hard to resist.
I was spending probably £80 three or four times in one night when spending those nights.
Loot boxes are increasingly in the hot seat. Countries around the world are examining whether they constitute gambling. Belgium banned loot boxes in 2018. And a proposed class action in Vancouver also alleges they violate gambling laws. All prompting this insider to contact Go Public when he saw an internal EA document discussing FIFA Ultimate Team, the mode of play that features loot boxes. It says it's a cornerstone. We are doing everything we can to drive players there, and all roads lead there. Someone else is reading the insider's words.
It's getting harder and harder to defend what is very obviously unregulated gambling that's meant to capitalize on people who obviously don't understand what's happening.
Loot box spending is generating massive profits for EA. Its sports titles alone raked in almost $1.5 billion in 2020. One of the world's leading researchers on loot boxes says all the controversy points to one thing about the industry.
Which is that it should no longer be trusted to self-regulate.
EA declined an interview request. A spokesperson said he wouldn't comment on confidential documents and said they were being viewed without context. He did say the company doesn't believe any aspect of its video games constitutes gambling. Erica Johnson, CBC News, Vancouver.
Meanwhile, Ontario's COVID Science Advisory Table has released what it calls the Way Forward, with a list of six things that will reduce COVID-19 transmissions. For more on these new recommendations, let's bring in Dr. Peter Uni. He's the table's scientific director. He's a professor at the University of Toronto. Dr. Uni, thank you for joining us here on the weekend. Appreciate your time.
Good morning, and thanks for having me.
Let's talk about what prompted these new recommendations.
Well, we just wanted to make sure that everybody's very clear about what is needed now. This is basically just a list of recommendations that makes a complete sense if you understand the epidemiology of this disease. It's a disease of essential workers and their families. It's a disease that is predominantly transmitted inside. If we actually just refer to these two different characteristics and then use common sense and a bit of scientific data, we're able to do the right thing.
Okay, so inside essential workers, that's pretty specific. How would you like to see those groups targeted?
So if you think about what's going on, where we were very weak, during the last months actually, is with a distinction between what is really essential work and what is not. Remember, it's challenging. If you're inside, this means that you always have a residual risk for transmission or infection. And therefore, you would like to have as few people as possible inside. So there should only be in a workplace if it's absolutely necessary for society to go on. Then, there's, of course, workplace safety. That's the other aspect. Then here we are coming again, with what is tremendously important. Only if you have a paid sick leave that actually works. A worker needs to be able, if they are ill today with a sore throat, needs to be able to call their employer and say, I have a sore throat, I'm not coming. That's it. Everything else needs to be looked after. That's when paid sick leave works in other jurisdictions. That's what we need to achieve.
We saw the Premier come out and say that this is something that they are working on to bridge that gap between a worker falling sick in Ontario. Okay, you're wagging the finger. Okay.
You see,
take it from
that's
there.
A misunderstanding.
Okay.
What he said is, which is a complete misunderstanding of the situation, he wants to bridge the gap for the few days that are not being paid. That's not the problem. We've seen the Premier struggling with a laptop, okay? So when you think about that, how is it for an essential worker who actually needs to apply for paid sick leave? The burden needs to be on the employers, and the employers need to know basically that if they continue to pay their salaries of the workers, that they will be able to get a refund. That's all. That's as simple as that. So the burden cannot be absolutely not on the essential workers. This doesn't work, and we've seen this in other jurisdictions go wrong. And if you want to have a proof of concept that it doesn't work, look at the federal paid sick leave program. It never worked properly.
So what do you want the province to do?
Well, first of all, either sick or have been exposed or need to get vaccinated or whatever the reason is. That's the way to get this part, you know, under control. And then, of course, we can help with properly vaccinating those places, those neighborhoods, etc., that need it most.
Is part of the issue around what has been a broad definition of essential worker? What, in your mind, is an essential worker?
Well, I think it's important just to really clearly distinguish between what needs to go on, essential goods that need to be distributed, of course, not only the essential ones, and what not necessarily has to be. I can't see, you know, that some luxury goods that need to be manufactured. I can't see that the condo building in downtown Toronto needs to continue. We just need to be very clear there now. This is not the time of compromises.
So, constructing of, say, health facilities or a school, I guess I'm just trying to get a more greater sense because there seems to be a lot of wiggle room in the definition, and regardless of what measures are taken, that presumably can expand the risk group exponentially in terms of having too broad a definition of who is allowed to work.
This is correct. You know, we're just talking about a few weeks now, so we need to be very careful what really remains essential. If we talk about, you know, constructions, probably the world will not come to an end if even a school construction, you know, just takes a little bit longer, for example. You know, there are very few, you know, construction situations where you probably just need to continue. And I can see it's also sometimes, you know, in people's homes where there's something really essential. I can see that there are some exceptions. But, you know, there is not much wiggle room there, and we just need to make sure that we are now really stringent. This is, you know, possible, and you absolutely must wear a mask all the time. You can't imagine what I see go wrong, even if I just, you know, if I just walk and I go and get some food sometimes, or if I look at the playground, you know, where kids are too close to each other and don't wear masks, we can do much better.
We've seen, for example, the closure at the Amazon plant. We've seen the outbreak there as it has gone on. But so many stores are closed. That's what I'm saying. When you define essential, is Amazon essential in the world we live in now? Or can more be done there?
I'm probably the wrong person to ask. I'm a scientist, but you know, I see that Amazon has a really important role to play right now with the distribution of goods. But what we need to be aware of is I have my serious concerns that Amazon does everything they can actually to keep their workers as safe as they can, and we just need to be aware of that. We need to get better there too, and it's the absolutely right decision of Lawrence Law and Eileen De Villa now to really say, okay, if we have an outbreak situation in a facility, we close these facilities. That's what is needed right now. We're too desperate.
Yeah, and just for our viewers, we're referencing Medical Officer Health for Peel Region and for Toronto, where they have invoked this Section 22, where there have been five cases over the course of a week or so. They're shutting down that workplace, just so people understand that. Okay, Dr. Yannis, you say you are a scientist. So as a scientist, what is your biggest concern at this stage of the pandemic?
Well, the biggest concern remains that our ICU occupancy goes up and up and up again. And remember, everybody, I hope, is aware of that now. We're talking about the young people around these ICUs. And it's a real challenge that we're facing there. We're really at the limits there. This means, even though we probably manage now as a first step, which is excellent, that's because of all of us, you know, doing the right thing, that the curve is flattening at a high plateau, we now need to get these numbers down as soon as possible. In addition, we need to use our vaccines as wisely as we can.
And that, by that, you mean target hotspot areas and target hotspot at-risk groups.
Exactly, including again essential workers and their families. You know, we have a challenge right now that we just need to address. If we want to do that well, we now need to benefit also from the indirect effects of vaccines. That's new data that came out just a few weeks ago that really indicate now we not only directly protect that person, by the vaccine from getting severely ill, but also protect indirectly other people who are not yet vaccinated, because this person who gets vaccinated is less likely to transmit the disease. And we need to leverage both of those. So if we go into hotspots that are actually severely affected and try to vaccinate everybody we can above the age of 16 or 18, this will then be hopefully 70 or 80%. This means that we achieve something like herd immunity in this area. And what this also means is that everybody there is protected, you know, most people at the highest risk. And it also means that these areas don't spill over to other areas, so everybody benefits. But this means we need to let go of the idea that we can do all of that just, you know, on a per capita basis, that the population size determines the number of vaccine doses. That's not what needs to happen now if we want to use vaccines wisely and want to make sure that the entire province benefits. The province benefits, then we get all the hotspots under control.
And that's certainly been something that Dr. Peter Lin has been advocating on our program for 4 weeks now. Dr. Yumi, I want to thank you for your time. Please enjoy the rest of your weekend.
Thanks for having me.
Dr. Peter Yumi is the Scientific Director of the Ontario COVID-19 Science Advisory Table and a Professor of Medicine and Epidemiology at the University of Toronto.
The line for a COVID-19 test snaked around the Halifax Convention Centre today. For those in the queue, the wait was worth it.
Just to be safe, just with the uptick in cases, it probably made sense. Be over 100 in the last 2 days, just to thank myself and those around.
The province reported 63 new cases Sunday. That's the highest daily number since the start of the pandemic, and it prompted a rare Sunday news conference from Premier Ian Rankin.
It's a disappointing weekend for us.
There are potential exposure sites in more than 20 communities. They include restaurants, bars, grocery stores, and public transit, and are spread throughout the province.
While the majority of cases are in Halifax area, it is now spread to every region of the province. The virus is spreading, and we have to find a way to contain it.
Nova Scotia is tightening restrictions. Officials are telling people not to travel outside their communities unless it's for work or medical appointments.
We need all Nova Scotians to know how serious our situation is. And I expect high numbers in the next few days.
To bring those numbers down, a new limit of 10 people for gatherings outside Halifax. The rule is still 5 inside the city. But after police handed out 22 tickets to partygoers at one Halifax home Friday night, the fine has been doubled to $2,000. Dalhousie University confirmed some attendees may have been students, and the school is considering suspensions.
Make no mistake, this is a serious situation with lives, jobs, and futures at stake. Each of us needs to respond with the necessary focus and caution.
As Nova Scotia tries to rein in its surge in new cases, some hospitals have canceled some elective procedures in order to build capacity for the thousands of COVID tests now underway. Matt Dunwoo, CBC News, Montreal.
So as more Canadians roll up their sleeves to get their shots, some still have questions about vaccines. So let's get right to that with infectious disease specialist Dr. Alex Wong, who is in Regina. Dr. Wong, let's start with the side effects of getting vaccinated. We got this question. Are there more general side effects with the AstraZeneca vaccine than Pfizer or Moderna?
I see. And so, great question. In short, there's no evidence per se to support that AstraZeneca has any additional or more side effects or more severe side effects than either of the mRNA vaccines. The most common side effects include fatigue, headache, fevers, aches and pains. Those usually go away in a couple of days. So if you get those types of side effects, taking a bit of Tylenol and ibuprofen to help will make it go away a bit quicker.
Some people, Dr. Wong, are wondering about mixing vaccines. Here's a question we got on video.
I was vaccinated with my first dose of the Moderna vaccine on April 10th. I'm going to be 50 this year. My question is, would it be advisable for me to be vaccinated with the AstraZeneca vaccine as my second dose?
Dr. Wong, what do you know about that?
So there's not a lot of true sort of clinical trial evidence right now to support sort of mixing and matching vaccines routinely. I think a lot of what's going to happen is probably going to end up being dictated to some degree by supply and demand of what's available. That being said, the current guidance is still, if at all possible, to try and have a second dose of vaccine, which is identical to the first dose that you received.
Dr. Wong, on Friday on the National, Bonnie Allen told us the heartbreaking story of Warren Montgomery, a well-known entrepreneur in Regina who recently died from COVID complications. I'm going to play an excerpt from that. This is his wife talking about fatigue over COVID restrictions.
I was sick of everything. Open it up. I was done. I wanted my family back. I wanted my dad to know this back. I wanted my parents back with everybody. And I was vocal about it. I couldn't have been more wrong.
Dr. Wong, you're on call today. What should we know about what's going on in your community?
You know, everybody in the community is tired. At the same time, our ICUs are overflowing, packed to the brim. People are being double bunked into rooms. Procedures are being canceled. So it really is a crisis. And, you know, I feel at times like in this province, we've at times reduced the pandemic to dashboard statistics, and it's really about people. People like Warren Montgomery who died tragically. People like, you know, people in our ICU right now. There was a gentleman who was in our ICU and his wife delivered their baby daughter by C-section, for example. I mean, these sorts of stories are happening every day. And so I just want people to remember that this pandemic is not about statistics and numbers. It's about real people and real lives. And we need to do everything possible in terms of the economic and mandated measures necessary in order to bring this curve down in this province as quickly and as aggressively as possible so we can avoid more deaths and more suffering.
I know it's a busy time for you, Dr. Wong. Thank you very much for making some time for us.
Always a pleasure, Ian. Thank you.
Doctors, nurses, and other health workers kept their demonstration short today. They don't want to be gathering, but feel they have no other choice.
Stop playing politics with people's lives!
Outside of the provincial legislature, the healthcare workers demanded employer-paid sick days and prioritizing essential workers and marginalized communities in the vaccine rollout.
People are dying, and that's why we're out here, and that's why we're asking for the specific measures that we know is boosted evidence.
The number of patients in Ontario ICUs with COVID-19 has been steadily increasing, reaching a record high each day for the past 19 days.
We're seeing people in the waiting room who should be in the ICU. Vaccines. I want vaccines like tomorrow. I want vaccines immediately.
So do the hundreds of residents who have been spending hours waiting in lineups like this one in Downsview, a Toronto COVID-19 hotspot.
We just line up early, hoping that, they haven't run out of vaccines.
Right now, a quarter of the province's vaccines go to hotspots. On Friday, Ontario's COVID-19 science advisory table said that number should go up to 50%, saying it would reduce case counts, hospitalizations, and deaths.
I would actually push even further or reframe the science table's recommendation and say, how comfortable are we allowing to continue to see people die and suffer in these neighborhoods?
These are our newest Canadians, our racialized Canadians, and to the extent that those structural inequities existed even before the pandemic, I think the pandemic simply worsened them.
Doctors know it'll be a while before they see relief.
I've never been more anxious than this pandemic.
Last week, Premier Doug Ford promised a paid sick leave program is coming. His office says they'll have more to say about it in the coming days. Talia Ricci, CBC News, Toronto.
It's dire. I can't reduce and cut costs any more than I have.
Mike, your worst one is in survival. He runs his pizza restaurant as best he can these days.
I have 5 employees that all have been laid off. I do 100% of the work. Accounting, cooking, answering the phone, and still not making a profit. So I keep doing it. I don't understand why I'm breaking my back when I don't see a light at the end of the tunnel.
That was the mindset Mike was in when he sat down to watch the budget.
I'm not a political guy. I'm just a hardworking, just average Joe. So it was weird for me to really watching every word when that budget came out. It was kind of like Game 7 of the Maple Leafs versus the Montreal Canadiens in the Stanley Cup final, like Game 7, the third period. I was waiting for it. I was watching every moment of it.
What Mike was looking for specifically was a continuation of the emergency rent subsidy, or SERS, that keeps the door open. And he got it.
I was elated. I almost was screaming because without that, I already was planning on June 5th closing. I wasn't going to make enough money. But in my own pocket to pay rent, the extension of SERS was the Maple Leafs winning in overtime in Game 7 for me. That allows me the opportunity to maybe weather this storm.
That's one of the ideas behind the budget, to help people like Mike to do business through the pandemic. Of course, there's a cost. Canada's deficit is projected to be $354 billion. The debt, $1.4 trillion by 2026.
I understand debt. I've seen every aspect of that. Debt for successful investments and debt that drove people into despair. I've seen it.
That's Ron Butler. In his 25 years as a mortgage broker, he's seen the way we think about debt change, big time.
We used to worry a lot about a $38 billion deficit. There was all kinds of discussion around it. So now we're running 10 times that. 10 times. And I don't hear very much concern from anyone.
What's changed from sweating about $38 billion to 10 times?
Certainly COVID happened. That's a big change. There was such a need to get money to people who lost their jobs that a big deficit was expected. Did go into a $345 billion deficit last year. The sky didn't fall in. Nothing went too wrong. So why not just do it again? We'll see how this rides out.
Ron says he sees the same spending behavior that the government's doing with every AP. He says we've forgotten the risk of taking on too much debt.
That's exactly what happens in the mortgage business. People refi their homes once. Somewhat larger payment, maybe about the same payment, because rates went down. Well, let's do it again. Rates are even lower. Let's refinance again. Let's get a bigger mortgage. Let's renovate the basement. Let's do this. Let's do that. Until the day comes when it doesn't work out. If I had grandchildren, what am I saddling them with?
You can argue about money for the present. For someone like Ezekiel, there's no pain. Every month she risks being evicted.
It's stressful, because I've missed a month. I've got big notices at my door. You're late. They can't be evicted.
Ezekiel's a mom of three. Before the pandemic, she was a cleaner. But in the last year, since COVID, she's only been able to work twice. And she says serve is not enough.
When it comes to paying the rent or buying food, it's a toss-up. I have to be thinking if I'm going to pay the rent or if I'm going to buy food, if I'm going to be able to feed my children or I'm going to be evicted. So it's not a nice feeling when you have to be thinking about one or the other.
Ezekiel tells me that for her, the budget was a disappointment.
I don't think the budget has done enough. The budget has not done enough to cover our needs, and I don't think that they even consulted with us. What do you need? What can we do for you? How does this budget will help you? When you're in low income, you're not able to say, oh, the budget is too much, you know, there's a deficit. We understand that there's a deficit, but right now we need assistance.
Ezekiel wants to get back to work and support herself, but for now, because of COVID, she's stuck. And that's the case for thousands of Canadians across the country. Mike's in the same boat. He hates that he can't support himself, that he needs government help to stay open.
The reason why I'm here and the reason why I'm passionate about the budget is to feed my family, to make sure that they're safe, they're sheltered, they're fed, keep them comfortable. I mean, this is the only reason why I'm here. And again, I don't know how long I can do that. And that's what the real scary part is.
After more than a year of COVID, the only thing we know is that the future is uncertain. And a budget all by itself can't put an end to that. Nick Burton, CC News, Toronto.
In Britain, a former key advisor to Boris Johnson is calling the Prime Minister unethical. Dominic Cummings, who is sacred in the chair, says the British PM used political donations for home renovations. This is Dominic Politis is following the story, and he joins us from Bristol, England. So, Dom, let's talk about what Cummings is saying, and he's not short of words, is he?
No, that's right, Donnie. Well, he's used his first blog post since leaving Downing Street last year. Firstly, it's to deny that he leaked text messages between Boris Johnson and Sir James Dyson, the creator of the Dyson vacuum cleaner. Those messages John was sent in March of last year, just after the government appealed for help from firms and building ventilators for Britain's pandemic response. And they show Boris Johnson promising to fix a tax issue for Dyson's Singapore-based staff if they move to the UK to help. Now, aside from that denial, Dominic Cummings also makes a number of other explosive claims in his 1,000-word blog. He alleges that Boris Johnson planned to get Tory donors to secretly pay for refurbishing his Downing Street apartment, and that Johnson suggested blocking an inquiry into another government leak about England's second national lockdown because the suspect was apparently a friend of his fiancée, Carrie Symons. But Cummings also alleges Johnson instructed his director of communications to make false accusations to the media, and he accuses Boris Johnson of, quote, falling far below the standards of competence and integrity which Britain deserves. So, explosive allegations and comments from Boris Johnson's former top aide and one of his closest allies at the time, a no-holds-barred attack on the Prime Minister, John, and it shows, I think, Dominic Cummings is willing to spill all about his time at the heart of British government, and that will be worrying for Boris Johnson and other Downing Street officials, John.
Well, let's talk about what kind of reaction we're getting from the Prime Minister's office now.
Yeah, well, first off, the government, Don, has denied any wrongdoing. It's insisting that ministers, including the Prime Minister, have acted in accordance with all the necessary rules, and that in particular, the costs of refurbishing the Downing Street apartment were met personally by Boris Johnson. But that statement just isn't enough for some opposition MPs, John, who are demanding the Prime Minister Boris Johnson fully discloses who actually paid for that work. Here's Sir Keir Starmer, leader of the Labour opposition party.
It matters because it's about integrity. It's about taxpayers' money. You've got the former most senior advisor to the Prime Minister saying he's fallen way below the standards of integrity that are needed for the office of Prime Minister. You've got the former minister, Dominic Grieve, saying there's a vacuum of integrity. But his sleeves, and frankly, it stinks.
John, other opposition MPs say that the claims show the government is neglecting the British people, that it is mired in sleaze, and they have called for a full investigation into the issue. John?
Those are some strong words. Thanks for this, Dominic. This is Dominic Valaitis in Brightstone.
Game played by tens of millions, FIFA Soccer, made by industry giant EA Electronic Arts. Embedded in the game, a mode where players can buy what's called a loot box card pack, either with coins earned in the game or with real cash. The random chance to get a better player for your team, and if you don't succeed, try again. Millions tune in to scenes like this. Gamers simply opening card packs, finding out what player they got. But for some people, hard to resist.
I was spending probably £80 three or four times in one night when spending that is most.
Loot boxes are increasingly in the hot seat. Countries around the world are examining whether they constitute gambling. Belgium banned loot boxes in 2018. And a proposed class action in Vancouver also alleges they violate gambling laws. All prompting this insider to contact Go Public when he saw an internal EA document discussing FIFA Ultimate Team, the mode of play that features loot boxes. It says it's a cornerstone. We are doing everything we can to drive players there, and all roads lead there. Someone else is reading the insider's words.
It's getting harder and harder to defend what is very obviously a regulated gambling that's meant to capitalize on people who obviously don't understand what is happening.
Loot box spending is generating massive profits for EA. Its sports titles alone raked in almost $1.5 billion in 2020. One of the world's leading researchers on loot boxes says all the controversy points to one thing about the industry,
which is that it should no longer be trusted to sell.
EA declined an interview request. A spokesperson said he wouldn't comment on confidential documents and said they were being viewed without context. He did say the company doesn't believe any aspect of its video games constitutes gambling. Erica Johnson, CBC News, Vancouver.
Pazio spoke to us a week after a racist attack left him bloodied and bruised and with a concussion. The memory of his night in hospital still hazy. The vicious attack still haunting.
That made me afraid to wear my own skin.
It happened in this field just behind where I'm standing now. Pazzo, a grade 8 student at Boston Junior High, was leaving school to go catch a bus. That's when a group of students chased and tackled him to the ground. The boys called him the N-word and made monkey sounds at him, Pazzo says.
I couldn't remember that much, and my head really hurt, and my neck.
Pazzo says his attackers are friends with a student who threatened him last year and was expelled for. When similar threats escalated this month, Pazzo was fearful, staying home for 2 days. When he returned, his fears came true.
It was not right, and it was not supposed to happen. And the school should have done something.
I think I'm going to get through.
This weekend, the school said students involved in the assault have been held accountable, but it won't say what that entailed, citing privacy laws. Advocates say the incident reaffirms the need for continued anti-racism education for staff and students.
You don't want a 10-year plan, you don't want a 5-year plan. It has to be in these next upcoming months to a year. Otherwise, you know it's just performative, and we're not here for that anymore.
Police say they are investigating, but the family is upset with how they questioned Pazzo, saying the officer pressed him on whether has stopped counting on the school for support, turning to community groups as they consider their next steps. Dylan Olmstead, CBC News, Edmonton.
But we want to get to some breaking news right now, and this is in southern Ontario, where two Amazon fulfillment centers have now been partially closed to control COVID-19 outbreaks. Now, the order is from Peel Regional Public Health. It's for Amazon's facilities in Brampton and Moulton, Ontario. New regional rules, they do allow temporary shutdowns in workplaces where five or more COVID cases have been detected over a two-week period. Closures, while they can last up to 10 days and require affected employees to isolate and refrain from working elsewhere. Now, without legislated paid sick days in Ontario, Peel Health is strongly recommending employers provide paid leave for workers. Now, Amazon has just released this statement about the closures. It reads as follows: "Nothing's more important than the health and safety of our employees and the communities we serve. We have done and are doing everything we can to support them. Our most recent round of mandatory testing confirmed a positivity rate of approximately 1%, and there appears to be little risk of spread within our facility." I will keep tracking that for you, but these closures do come as Ontario tries to stem its surging COVID-19 numbers. The province reporting 4,094 new cases today. That is slightly down from yesterday, and sadly, there were also 24 more deaths. As Ontario's numbers rise, so is the number of people needing treatment. Hospital, and many are even being transferred hundreds of kilometers away, in particular in the Greater Toronto Area. Let's be Laura McQuillan, who has more on this story. So Laura, talk to us about how hospitals right now are busy trying to relieve some of the pressure they currently face.
Yeah, they only do send dozens of patients per day, Michael, to other hospitals and more room for ICU patients to free up their own ICU beds. What we've learned is that in the past day there have been another 38 patients transferred, and in fact this month 747 patients so far. So this month alone, and we're not at the end of the month yet, there have been more than half of the year's total. Such is the rise in the number of patients needing intensive care beds and the effort to find them a bed somewhere in the province. As you mentioned, they're hundreds of kilometres away. We're talking going from Toronto to Ottawa or to Windsor or to Owen Sound just to try and find room for them on flights and ambulances, as you're seeing there on the screen. Doctors have been warning of this for months, the situation in intensive care units. And an expression I keep hearing is, Ontario is on fire, but the fire really is burning the hottest in those intensive care units, to the point where we're having these patient transfers in Ontario, and also where field hospitals are opening up. One at Sunnybrook Hospital set to open its doors on Monday, according to doctors who work at that hospital. You see it there, military-style tents set up in a parking lot. That facility will take in some 84 patients who are recovering from COVID, but the hospital says that it could relieve some other hospitals if they do need to transfer patients there as well, because that squeeze is expected to continue. Right now, 833 patients in intensive care in Ontario, that is around double what we saw at the peak of the second wave, a number that is expected to keep growing. Nearly three quarters of those patients on ventilators, just to give you an idea of how bad things are. And we have been getting an idea of that from Dr. Shadi Amshala, and he is the head of general surgery at Sunnybrook Hospital, where you saw that field hospital. He's been walking us through what all of this means, the flow-on effects for elsewhere in the healthcare system in terms of surgery particularly. Here is something that he told us.
We have shifted into what we're calling a crisis standard of care. That means that the normal standard of care that Ontarians deserve and expect is no longer an option for many disease processes because of the impact of our COVID-19 patients on our system. Everybody needs to know that there are patients out there who should be having their cancers removed, that are sitting with their cancers in their body, waiting patiently to happen to them. We need to know the gravity of what's happening.
And Dr. Ashimala telling us that he was just in the sense of disbelief when he heard from the Ontario government that they had been waiting to see if the modelling would flow through to intensive care units, because that is exactly where we find ourselves now. The modelling was realised. He is urging the government to do more to stem the number of cases heading into ICU, with measures that we've heard many people talking about, including protecting essential workers, because doctors have been crying out for weeks and months now, Michael. They are so concerned, not just about where the intensive care units and the hospitals are now, but where things will go next, because it will be at least a few weeks before any restrictions take the bigger effect in hospitals.
Okay, Laura, thank you for that.
boxes of medical supplies into every nook and cranny of her small home. They were for her husband, Percy, who had end-stage renal failure. All the equipment needed for his care turned their home into an obstacle course. All we had was like 4 feet. You know, little alleys in our house. Towards the end, like, when it was an amazing, you know, sense of balance and mobility. It was quite concerning. Percy died waiting for a home renovation that could have drastically improved his quality of life. The Hardesties couldn't afford to pay for a small room addition to store Percy's necessities. So they asked the NWT Housing Corporation for a loan. But Hardesty says they never heard back.
Well, it just kind of, you know, makes you want to give up.
In the Northwest Territories, stories like this are common. Most homes in small communities are owned by the territorial government and managed by the Housing Corporation. Almost half are in dire need of repair. But despite many funding programs, few get the upgrades they need.
So there is good reason, Mr. Speaker, for the centrality of housing. There is no good reason, Mr. Speaker, that we are not providing it.
Last month, the legislature launched a review of the Housing Corporation's policies, but it will take months to complete.
You know, we deal with this on a daily basis.
Advocates say the territory needs to keep the agency accountable.
Because there really isn't any kind of independent type of oversight where people can actually bring their concerns.
The Housing Corporation says anyone needing help should go to their district office. Hardesty says that's not enough. She wants a dedicated representative to help people navigate the complicated system, in the hopes that other families don't struggle in their homes the way her husband did in his final days. Anna Demarest, CBC News, Fort Simpson, Northwest Territories.
Tap your shower just to the point where you can get it to start, and that's the coldest. That is like a challenge for me to stay under. Shower sets the tone for the rest of my day.
After I had my daughter 18 months ago, I suffered from some pretty bad postpartum anxiety. Well, the main thing for me when I was kind of in the worst of it was making sure that I just had a routine. And then part of the routine is outdoor time, going outside for a nice walk. We live out in Lanark Highlands, which is in the middle of nowhere. It's very wooded where we are. We're lucky enough to have some trails that were made on the property that deer also like to use. Little rabbit tracks in the winter, you can see all the animals. And you can just hear the wind, right? You can just like feel the trees like breathing. It sounds weird, but like, it's definitely like having a nature bath. We have a toddler, so it takes a long time to walk places. She takes little steps, and we take little steps. Being outside with the chicken and the guinea hens, it's fun for my daughter, and when I see her laugh, that makes me happy. So doing things that make you happy during the day and that fill you up are really important. Because I was probably dealing with this anxiety from anxious new mom. It wasn't until I had my first panic attack that it really clicked with me that I was probably struggling with something a little more intense than just a run-of-the-mill. I'm 57 years old. I suffer from depression since I was 33. I couldn't wake up, get out of the bed, and I couldn't walk. During this time, I had a friend introduce me.
The advice I could give to someone who's struggling with their mental health right now is you really gotta focus on what you can control, and you have to practice being positive. You're not entitled to being happy. You have to work to be happy.
I would say that you really need to take a moment for yourself during the day and give yourself grace. The most helpful thing is control. You know, this experience was like on an airplane. If your airplane is going down or the oxygen mask drops, you can put yourself first before you put it on somebody else.
And I told myself, I know I've been there, I've done that. I know no matter how deep I've down there before, and I come out of it. I'm not scared anymore. It's a physical illness, it's a mental illness, it's a illness you just need.
So as more Canadians roll up their sleeves to get their shots, some still have questions about vaccines. So let's get right to that with infectious disease specialist Dr. Alex Wong, who is in Regina. Dr. Wong, let's start with the side effects of getting vaccinated. We got this question. Are there more general side effects with the AstraZeneca vaccine than Pfizer or Moderna?
I see. And so, great question. In short, there's no evidence per se to support that AstraZeneca has any additional or more side effects or more severe side effects than either of the mRNA vaccines. The most common side effects include fatigue, headache, fevers, aches and pains. Those usually go away in a couple of days. So if you get those types of side effects, taking a bit of Tylenol and ibuprofen to help will make it go away a bit quicker.
Some people, Dr. Wong, are wondering about mixing vaccines. Here's a question we got on video.
I was vaccinated with my first dose of the Moderna vaccine on April 10th. I'm going to be 50 this year. My question is, would it be advisable for me to be vaccinated with the AstraZeneca vaccine as my second dose?
Mm-hmm. Dr. Wong, what do you know about that?
So there's not a lot of true sort of clinical trial evidence right now to support sort of mixing and matching vaccines routinely. I think a lot of what's going to happen is probably going to end up being dictated to some degree by supply and demand of what's available. That being said, the current guidance is still, if at all possible, to try and have a second dose of vaccine, which is identical to the first dose that you received.
Dr. Wong, on Friday on the National, Bonnie Allen told us the heartbreaking story of Warren Montgomery, a well-known entrepreneur in Regina who recently died from COVID complications. I want to play an excerpt from that. This is his wife talking about fatigue over COVID restrictions.
I was sick of everything. Open it up. I was done. I wanted my family back. I wanted my get-togethers back. I wanted my friends back. Like everybody. And I vocal about it, I couldn't have been more wrong.
Dr. Wong, you're on call today. What should we know about what's going on in your community?
You know, everybody in the community is tired. At the same time, our ICUs are overflowing, packed to the brim. People are being double-bunked into rooms. Procedures are being canceled. So it really is a crisis. And, you know, I feel at times like in this province, we've at times reduced the pandemic to dashboard statistics, and it's really about people. People like Warren Montgomery, who died tragically. People like, you know, people in our ICU right now. There was a gentleman who was in our ICU, and his wife delivered their baby daughter by C-section, for example. I mean, these sorts of stories are happening every day. And so I just want people to remember that this pandemic is not about statistics and numbers. It's about real people and real lives. And we need to do everything possible in terms of the economic and mandated measures necessary in order to bring this curve down in this province as quickly and as aggressively as possible, so we can avoid more deaths and more suffering.
I know it's a busy time for you, Dr. Wong. Thank you very much for making some time for us.
Always a pleasure, again. Thank you.
It's deja vu inside Alberta hospitals. Exponential community spread driving hundreds of patients into hospital beds.
Is this our third wave? Should be better at this by now. We know what works. We're making the numbers. We know that it takes good government policies.
Alberta's daily case rate this week was the worst in the country by far. And healthcare workers say hospitals are going to shoulder that burden. As of today, 600 people were in hospital, 140 in intensive care, numbers approaching the heights of the second wave.
We are going to exceed the last wave ICU by a large number, and the only thing that's going to limit that is the announcement of restrictions.
The last round of restrictions, brought in early this month, banned dine-in service and put caps on business. On Friday, Alberta's health minister said they won't rule out more.
Our leadership.
These case numbers are fueled by variants. The majority of patients in Alberta hospitals have the B.1.1.7 variant, first discovered in the UK.
We're starting to now see people in their 20s, 30s, and 40s, you know, presenting with severe COVID-19 and facing the real proposition of needing to be placed on a ventilator to save their life.
In tourist popular but tiny Bath, with cases soaring, locals are calling for a targeted solution. Residents want all adults vaccinated.
Fighting against the virus coming from all places in Alberta. It's not fair. It's a small community. We have, you know, only so many resources.
And Alberta hospitals are in the same boat. Erin Broming, CBC News, Winnipeg.
Coming every day. There are more than 2,000, 3,000
widespread criticism also of both the state apparatus and the central government, but this is an unprecedented crisis. Prime Minister of India, Narendra Modi, has been in the fact that the executive committees all through the day, today and for the last few days, there's been some criticism also of the election rally that were happening in West Bengal and some of the religious campaigns as well. But as of now, all preparations are for both beds to arrive in several hospitals in Delhi, because I have started with my friends, with my network, a crisis network for COVID, and I haven't seen this kind of helplessness in people who are searching for beds, oxygen, or injections or medicine. So this is an unprecedented crisis that can't mark rare, and India is certainly tackling this bravely. I mean, it's only the resilience of the people on the streets of New Delhi and elsewhere in India that is keeping the nation going. But unfortunately, even in New Delhi, more than 350 people are dying every day. That means 15 deaths taking place every hour.
Aditya, how did this happen? Because just a few months ago, India was doing fine. In fact, one of the leading world producers of the vaccine, they were sending vaccines to Canada. We were depending on those vaccines. And now, what was the switch, the catalyst to this dramatic surge in cases?
Well, Natasha, there are various reasons. One, as I mentioned, there's been a lot of criticism of the lackluster approach at the federal and the state level as well. There are several state governments that have been criticized for not preparing enough. And also the kind of hard line that was approached, the kind of discipline that was there over the last 1 year or so, had really, gone haywire, because people were almost used to being in this, COVID-friendly environment, if I had to say. So COVID-appropriate behavior hasn't really been, disciplined enough all across the country. Secondly, the government was prepared, but unfortunately did not understand or gauge that this kind of unprecedented numbers could also happen. Also, there is a new variant that is coming, and there are multiple new variants that are coming, not just in New Delhi, but different other states as well, which scientists haven't been able to research in detail. I will give you an example of my old friend who has been in his house for more than 2 weeks. He has had no access to outside world, but he's going to post them as well. So, scientists are still trying to figure out how things are unfolding, but it doesn't seem like that things will get normal anytime soon in Delhi, at least for the next 15 to 20 days. The numbers are only going to swing up. As of now, as I speak, there's a lockdown underway for the last 1 week in the national capital, New Delhi. And if things remain this way, 25,000 cases coming in every day in the national capital, I sense a further lockdown, unfortunately.
25,000 possible cases every day. So Aditya, help me, we don't have a lot of time left, but you talked about a sense of helplessness, but at the same time, so many people coming together, rallying together. I've noticed so much activity on social media, trying to tell people where beds are available, where they can send donations, things like that. Just give me a sense of what this has done to the individual families who are struggling right now, who can't find hospital beds.
Well, I have messages in my inbox on Twitter, on all across the social media, and asking for help. And I've been posting that individually over the last many days. And unfortunately, there are no beds available in Delhi government hospitals or private hospitals. As I said, hospitals, each and every hospital in Delhi is running at about 50% capacity. So you can imagine the lives of several innocents are at risk. The patients are shattered. It is the resilience of the common man here in India that is, shaping the entire movement of helping the common people. There are several WhatsApp groups that have been created, that are individuals and NGOs and common people really coming up and helping people. I've been part of one, maybe in Planned Parenthood, and with doctors and individuals from the forces and different state of society, we are trying to help people. And, I'll give an example of just an hour that is midnight here in India. We were finally able to secure a bed for father of an Indian Air Force personnel who was not getting a bed for the last 2 days, even though he was clinical. So you can imagine there was a thunderous applause virtually all across the volunteers, and after several hours, we were able to manage this bed for this individual. So I don't want to criticize the central government or the state government at this stage, because this is no time to, for mudslinging. But, the government needs to take the bed, and the first collapse is yet to come. We haven't touched this, peak. I don't want to call this a second wave or the fourth wave, as the politicians refer to this. But unfortunately, resume with credit.
Welcome back. While the international charity Doctors Without Borders is urging rich countries to take steps to allow more coronavirus vaccines to be produced right around the world, it is a topic that's sparking debate among members of the World Trade Organization. Now, intellectual property rights prevent other countries from making domestic versions of vaccines, but waiving these rights would allow developing nations to produce vaccines without fear of reprisal. Over 100 Nobel laureates and 75 world leaders, former world leaders, have already signed a letter to U.S. President Joe Biden, calling on him to suspend patents during the pandemic. But resistance to this plan, while it has been fierce, the U.S., the U.K., and the EU all voted in March to block any waiver. Canada says it has not rejected the proposal, but here is more of what we are hearing from Doctors Without Borders. Take a look. They say, quote, "We urge all countries in opposition to this, including the U.S. and the EU, to stand on the right side of history and join hands with those in support. It is about saving lives at the end, not protecting systems." Well, joining us now is one of the Nobel laureates who signed this letter to U.S. President Joe Biden, the University of Alberta, Dr. Michael Houghton, won the 2020 Nobel Prize in Medicine for his discovery of the hepatitis C virus, and he is currently working on a vaccine for COVID-19. He joins us in San Francisco. Dr. Houghton, thank you for being with us today.
My pleasure.
Now, we have to note the fact that you've worked with pharmaceutical companies, with the industry for years now, but you have actually decided to sign on to this letter. Why?
Well, I think we're in a dire crisis, obviously, with this terrible pandemic. And I think emergencies require innovative solutions. We're simply not getting enough vaccine to poorer countries. It's so slow, and we have to do something about it. So this is very unusual to suspend patents, but I think it's justified to try to rectify this inadequate supply of vaccines to developing and poorer countries.
Okay. You say inadequate supply, but what would dropping a patent effectively do?
Well, it enables countries around the world to use the patent to manufacture their own vaccines without being sued by the companies that own those patents. So it gives a free license, essentially, for different countries to manufacture vaccines. And many countries, this has been led by India and South Africa, believe it's required to give their populations vaccine faster.
Now, pharmaceuticals, you need to know this, argue that patents ensure profits and that leads to life-saving research and drugs. So what do you say to this kind of pushback? Because we are seeing pushback to this proposal already.
Yeah, well, as you pointed out, I've been in the pharma industry myself, and patents there are very stimulatory. They are responsible for innovation, and most of the medicines we have today are because of the patent system, so it's a very good system. But in this circumstance where we have this terrible pandemic, we need to respond in different ways. We can't just rely on old methods. We're simply not getting enough vaccine to most countries of the world, and as a result, people are dying. And so I think extreme situations require extreme measures, and that's why I think it's a good idea to suspend COVID vaccines patents temporarily.
It's interesting that you use the word global, because it does raise quite literally a first world issue here, because many people in wealthy countries like Canada understandably are focused on their own pandemic protections, but they're also not thinking about poor countries that cannot buy vaccines the way Canada has to respond to this pandemic. So what do you say to that kind of thinking, that people are really only focusing on their own countries and perhaps maybe neighboring country like the United States or other Western countries like the UK?
Yes, I would say that this is a global pandemic, and none of us can be truly completely protected until most of the world's citizens are vaccinated, at least 80%, so that we have herd immunity around the globe. So none of us will be completely protected until all the world's population, or 80% at least, are vaccinated. So it's protecting ourselves as well as doing the right thing to make the vaccine more available to poorer countries around the world. We cannot really justify any situation where rich countries are being protected and not poor countries. And there are other things that have to be put in place besides suspension of patents, like rectifying global supply chains. countries will have to put in place complex biomanufacturing facilities. They're going to require not just patent suspension, but technology transfer from the companies. But I think this is what we need to do. So patent suspension is one of the things we've got to do. And we just got to be better about working together to make sure everyone around the world gets vaccinated in the fastest possible time.
You say you have to be better at working together. And earlier on this pandemic, there seemed to be more global cooperation. What do you say now to this situation? Have things gotten worse as this pandemic has gone forward?
Well, I think, as you said, it's natural that countries, individual countries, have first priority on their own citizens. That's why we elect our officials to look after us. But, you know, all of us also want to see other people protected. And so I think we have to, you know, break the mold temporarily. And, you know, I think it will be a wonderful thing also, humanitarian-wise, for all of us to say, well, okay, we're going to do this because, you know, we are citizens, all citizens on a small planet, and viruses do not respect boundaries and immigration control. And so this is for them and it's for us. We have to work together better to solve this pandemic.
Now, this letter focuses on the U.S. president, but now the WTO is being raised, the World Trade Organization, now, of course, being a global decision-making body. So how important
is that, please.
Biden on side? How important would it be for the United States to change its sort of position on patents? And what role does that play for countries like Canada?
Yeah, I think it would be enormously important to have the support of President Biden. Also, the Canadian government has said that so far it will rely on the consensus decision of the WTO, and I think that's good. But we need the support of the UK government and the EU. And I think it's difficult because it's in a vagary and we're not used to this kind of situation. But I really would urge all governments around the world to get on board with this. It's one of the things we really need to do to solve this global pandemic. And I think it will be just a wonderful gesture for all mankind to say, look, we're finally figuring out how to help everyone, not just ourselves.
Dr. Michael Howard, thank you for this.
Thank you, sir.
Meanwhile, Ontario's COVID science advisory table calls the way forward with a list of six things that will reduce COVID-19 transmissions. More on these new recommendations, let's bring in Dr. Peter Yuni. He's the table scientific director and professor at the University of Toronto. Dr. Yuni, thank you for joining us here on the weekend. Appreciate your time.
Good morning. Thanks for having me.
Let's talk about what prompted these new recommendations.
Well, just wanted to make sure that everybody is very clear about what is needed now. You know, this is basically just a list of recommendations that makes a complete sense if you understand the epidemiology of this disease. It's a disease of essential workers and their families. It's a disease that is predominantly transmitted inside. If we actually just refer to these two different characteristics and then use common sense and a bit of scientific data, you're able to do the right thing.
Okay, so inside essential workers, that's pretty specific. How would you like to see those groups targeted?
So if you think about what's going on, where we were very weak during the last months actually is with a distinction between what is really essential work and what is not. Remember, it's challenging. If you're inside, this means that you always have a residual risk for transmission or infection. And therefore, you would like to have as few people as possible inside. So there should only be in a workplace if it's absolutely necessary for society to go on. Then, there's, of course, workplace safety. That's the other aspect. Then here we are coming again, with what is tremendously important. Only if you have a paid sick leave that actually works. A worker needs to be able, if they are ill today with a sore throat, needs to be able to call their employer and say, I have a sore throat, I'm not coming. That's it. Everything else needs to be looked after. That's when paid sick leave works in other jurisdictions. That's what we need to achieve.
We saw the Premier come out and say that this is something that they are working on to bridge that gap between worker phoning and sick in Ontario. Okay, I see. Well, you're wagging the finger. Okay.
You see,
take it from
that's
there.
A misunderstanding.
Okay.
What he said is, which is a complete misunderstanding of the situation, he wants to bridge the gap for a few days that are not being paid. That's not the problem. We've seen the premier struggling with a laptop. Okay? So, when you think about that, you know, how is it for an essential worker who actually needs to apply for paid sick leave? The burden needs to be on the employers, and the employers need to know, basically, that if they continue to pay their salaries of the workers, that they will get a refund, that's all. That's as simple as that. So the burden cannot be absolutely not on the essential workers. This doesn't work, and we've seen this in other jurisdictions go wrong, and if you want to have a proof of concept that it doesn't work, look at the federal sick leave program, it never worked properly.
So what do you want the province to do?
Well, first of all, I'm not in a position to, well, I can tell you what is needed, you know, but
yeah.
It's not about whether I want it or not, but if we want to get this now under control, and remember, we only achieved a flattening of the curve, our ICU emissions continue to go up. If we want to get this under control, we need a really short list of essential workplaces that need to stay open. Everything else needs to close. Then we need to make sure that people are being paid in a practical way for staying home if they're sick or have been.
Schedule a ride for today. I meant to do it last Thursday and I came and I called and I did something else and forgot about it. It's kind of urgent. It's not an emergency, it's just that I've been seeing the chiropractor, and it's the most important part of my treatment right now. Can I schedule a ride for today? The appointment is at 2:30.
2:30 for tonight?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, do you have your ID number?
Yes, I do. Yeah, that's where I live. And then you have to ask for chiropractic. Aurora Healthcare Center, Wisconsin American Drive. I'm not sure the numbers. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Dr. Donovan. Yes, ma'am. I have a walker. I just got a walker. But I can't carry it down the porch steps, so I don't take it with me to my health care appointment.
Okay.
Yes. Yes.
Thank you for your hold. I apologize for the wait. So I called over to the facility, and they are not open yet.
That's what I thought, yeah.
For anybody, you can give us a call back after they open.
Yes, ma'am.
And then we can try to call them back.
Okay. All right, sure. And I'll ask them if it's urgent. If they say no, should I just call and cancel or just not call? Right, okay. 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 All right, thank you so much for your help.
You're welcome.
You too. Bye-bye. Yeah, I thought it was you. Thank you.
I'm gonna order him around. She could be somebody, huh? Sure don't. Let me see her. Because you're not there. I hear. Yeah. Thank you.
medical facility. Please hang up and dial 911. For COVID testing, press 5. Next to the patient, press 8. For pharmacy, press 1. For the urgent care department, press 2. For the chiropractic department, press 3. For lab, press 4. One moment, please. One moment, please. You have reached the after-hours answering service for Aurora Healthcare. If this is a life-threatening emergency, please hang up and dial 911 or go to the nearest emergency department. For after-hours assistance, please remain on the line to speak to one of our healthcare representatives. This call may be recorded for quality assurance and training purposes. Advocate Aurora wants you to be aware of the best resources.
That's a name. The father? That's putting a whole bag of shit. God made sure of it. She never burst in. Oh, shit. I never turned this one off. Thought I did. I'm gonna stop recording and start again.